Hi guys, I'm Sjin, and welcome to part 2 of our Dear Esther Let's Play. Last episode we got done with chapter 1, and now we're moving ever closer to the Red Signal Tower. And we're moving on to chapter 2, The Boy.
Dear Esther, I have now driven the stretch of the M5 between Exeter and Bristol over 21 times. But although I have all the reports and all the witnesses, and have cross-referenced them within a millimeter using my ordnance survey maps, I simply cannot find the location. You'd think there would be marks to serve as some evidence. It's somewhere between the turnoff for Sanford and the welcome break services. But although I can always see it in my rearview mirror, I have as yet been unable to pull ashore.
Strange. M5, Bristol. It's not too far from me. Some kind of cargo ship. Those look like cargo containers. Yes. It's small. Is that two ships? Part of the same broken ship? We'll have to get closer.
I've begun to wonder if Donnelly's voyage here was as prosaic as it was presented. How disappointed not to have found the bones of the holy man. No wonder he hated the inhabitants so. To him, they must have seemed like barnacles mindlessly clinging to a mercy seat. Why cling so hard to the rock? Because it is the only thing that stops us from sliding into the ocean, into oblivion.
The boy, I suppose that's the boy, out in the sea, bobbing, yellow light flashing. Let's take this path, get close to the ship. It was pointed out last video in the comments that the chemical formula on the wall was ethanol, so nobody was making a cure. Nothing of interest, it seems, around this ship. Empty cargo crates. Bridge, see if we can see anything. No. No. Windy. Let's check out the tip of the coast before we head closer to the Red Signal Tower.
There must be a hole in the bottom of the boat. How else could new hermits have arrived?
What's that written on the side? Eat nor drink. Neither did he eat nor drink. And neither did he eat nor drink. Is that a reference to something? Perhaps a passage? from the Bible, perhaps? Some other text?
I had kidney stones and you visited me in the hospital. After the operation, when I was still half submerged in anesthetic, your outline and your speech both blurred. Now my stones have grown into an island and made their escape, and you have been rendered opaque by the car of a drunk.
The road splits again. Let's take the low road this time.
Is this what Paul saw through his windscreen? Not Lot's wife looking over her shoulder, but a scar in the hillside falling away to black forever.
Strange pit. Let's see if we can make it around the edge. Do not want to fall in there. House. The silhouette of a house. Is that a house? I think it is.
I've begun my ascent on the green slope of the western side. I've looked deep into the mountain from the shaft and understood that I must go up and then find the way under. I will stash the last vestiges of my civilization in the stone walls and work deeper from there. I'm drawn by the aerial and the cliff edge. There is some form of rebirth waiting for me there.
What's going on here? Medical equipment. Empty blood packs, bottles of something. The jump key, so I don't want to get stuck behind these logs or a rock.
The bothy was constructed originally in the early 1700s. By then, shepherding had formalized into a career. The first habitual shepherd was a man called Jakobsen from a lineage of migratory Scandinavians. He was not considered a man of breeding by the mainlanders. He came here every summer whilst building the bothy, hoping eventually that becoming a man of property would secure him a wife and a lineage. Donnelly records that it did not work. He caught some disease from his malcontented goats and died 2 years after completing it. There was no one to carve white lines into the cliff for him either.
White lines, the ones we saw on the wall.
Three cormorants seen at dusk. They did not land. This house built of stone, built by a long dead shepherd. Contents: my camp bed, a stove, a table, chairs, my clothes, my books. The caves that score out the belly of this island, leaving it famished. My limbs and belly famished. This skin, these organs, this failing eyesight. When the battery runs out in my torch, I will descend into the caves and follow only the phosphorescence home.
Strange ultrasound pictures. Cracked eggs. Eggshells. Empty boxes. Did we check this building? I don't think we did. Nope. 1,000 cool points for anyone who can tell me what that is. Doesn't look like ethanol. Steep. What's in that cave? Can we get to it? I don't think so. Path gets narrow.
He left his body to the medical school and was duly opened out for a crowd of students 21 days after his passing. The report is included in my edition of his book. The syphilis had torn through his guts like a drunk driver, scrambling his organs like eggs on a plate. But enough definition remained for a cursory examination, and as I suspected, they found clear evidence of kidney stones. He's likely to have spent the last years of his life in considerable pain. Perhaps this is the root of his laudanum habit. Although its use makes him an unreliable witness, I find myself increasingly drawn into his orbit. They found Jakobsen in early spring. The thaw had only just come. Even though he'd been dead nearly 7 months, his body had been frozen right down to the nerves and had not even begun to decompose. He'd struggled halfway down the cliff path, perhaps looking for some lost goat, or perhaps in a delirium, and expired, curled into a claw right under the winter moon. Even the animals shunned his corpse. The mainlanders thought to bring it home unlucky. Donnelly claims they dragged it to the caves to thaw out and rot. But he is proving an unreliable witness.
Poor Jakobsen. Didn't quite make it down the cliff path before he froze into a block of ice. Let that be a lesson to anybody that wants to move to some strange English island and herd goats.
Climbing down to the caves, I slipped and fell and have injured my leg. I think the femur is broken. It is clearly infected. The skin has turned a bright, tight pink, and the pain is crashing in on waves, winter tides against my shoreline, drowning out the ache of my stones. I struggled back to the bothy to rest, but it has become clear that there is only one way this is likely to end. The medical supplies I looted from the trawler have suddenly found their purpose. They will keep me lucid for my final ascent.
Supplies make sense now. This is a scary cave. I don't know if I want to go in. Look at that reflection. That's wonderful. Well, I think that's a good place to call it at this episode. So thanks for watching. I've been Sjin. Hit subscribe, and I will see you next time.